Die DA se besprekingsdokument oor ekonomiese geregtigheid is Vrydag bekendgestel. Is dit die plan wat die land nodig het? Gwen Gwenya, die party se beleidshoof, sit hier ook aan my. Gwen, we're in an economic crisis that became clear again this week with the recession numbers. In the short term, if you were in government now based on this plan for progress and redress, what would you do immediately?
Well, some of the more immediate interventions have to do with, for example, addressing childhood stunting, which has long-term consequences and also affects the efficacy of later intervention. So we propose that we would introduce a food grant that would match the food poverty line. That's a rather immediate, as an example of a rather immediate intervention.
You speak too about wages though, cutting the wages of the best paid managerial class, saving 136 billion rand in the process, and giving new entrants into the job market the option to forego the minimum wage, to say, yeah, we don't want to be subject to that. Why?
Well, I mean, there's precedents. We got the idea, Germany has this model where they do have a national minimum wage, but they do have exemptions for particular classes or groups of people. And the long-term unemployed are such a group. And the thinking is that if you've gone 12 months without being able to secure a job, then your options there is not between a higher wage or a lower wage, it's between a low wage or no wage at all. And that those people should be able to apply for exemption to be able to get a job at a wage that they are prepared to agree to. But I would just add very quickly to say that these particular interventions are kind of secondary. The very first step that we would need agreement on is that the current model of redress that focuses on kind of elite transfers has not worked, and that we want a more bottom-up approach that focuses on the drivers of inequality of opportunity on the ground. Once you've agreed on that approach, then you can start to quibble about what are the specific interventions that you would want to make.
Okay, but there's a very stubborn consensus in the commentariat and of course in the governing class that race is the prism through which we need to look for historical reasons at the problem of redress, and that remains a necessary evil, as you put it in the document. Why do you think that's not the case?
Well, firstly, I mean, it's challenging because current policies have had almost a decade to really find acceptance within the public mind. They were debated for years, and I think people are wanting to find the same kind of consensus on our draft policy in a matter of days. So again, the comparison is really ill-fitting, but we think we can move to a model of disadvantage precisely because the majority of South Africans who are poor happen to be black. So it makes sense that any policy that is going to be pro-poor or based solely on disadvantage will have as its primary beneficiaries also black South Africans.
Right. Are there precedents in the existing South African policy framework of government for a means test instead of a racially based redress policy?
Yes, I mean, we use means testing in NSFAS and also in social grants, and there's never been any complaint that social grants accrue mostly to white South Africans at the exclusion of black South Africans, which goes to show that a policy of redress based on a means test would in a similar fashion have the same kind of beneficiaries.
So the suggestion to drop BEE and most of the labour legislation for companies with a turnover of under 30 million rands, how do you expect that will play among voters, you know, because we're heading for a local government election next year. This will be scrutinized to some extent, at least by voters.
Yeah, well, I think in terms of a policy that's an alternative to BEE, it would play quite well. Almost any kind of reading of the public perception that we've seen shows the public deeply feels that BEE has not actually benefited the majority. From whether you look at a polls done by the Institute of Race Relations or even the Institute for Justice and Reconciliation, which runs a South Africa Reconciliation Barometer, where they ask for perceptions around BEE, the policy is deeply disfavoured amongst many South Africans. But of course the trick is how it is communicated. The reality is most South Africans are not going to read a policy document like we have drafted, which is why it's so important that those who do then read it, the commentariat and others, are able to represent it in an accurate fashion, so the sound bites are correct. So I think actually far more than winning the policy battle, which I think if you are looking just at the policy, it's easy for us to win the policy battle. But the real battle we actually need to win is the communication battle over it, which is much harder.
Okay, and you will want to convince corporate South Africa that they need to be measured against the UN's Sustainable Development Goals of 2015 instead of the BEE scorecard, which has been in existence for more than a decade here. In short, what is the logic behind this move to these so-called SDGs, the Sustainable Development Goals?
Yeah, well, one, because they found global global support, and some of the detractors of BEE policy have actually been international investors. So the latest business climate survey, which was conducted by the EU Chamber of Commerce in South Africa, now that's important because they represent our largest trading bloc of countries, and they highlighted BEE as their top legislative challenge to doing business in South Africa, whereas the SDG goals are a global framework that already has the political buy-in of some of the top listed companies in the world, as well as governments. Also, because they're a global reporting standard, it means that international investors can easily comply. And just one last thing that I would add is that not only are we able to say that this framework would not deter investment, we strongly believe it would actually drive investment, because there are many asset managers globally who are specifically looking to invest in companies with strong SDG commitments and awareness. And I think the moment South African companies signal that, we would actually see investment flow into those companies.
If we want to kickstart growth, Gwen, how important is it to tell investors and South African public that property rights will be strengthened under a possible DA administration instead of undermined?
Well, I mean, absolutely critical. And we also are at pains in the document to say that ours is a growth-first agenda. You cannot pursue inclusion at the expense of growth. Growth measures and those that promote growth have to come first. And that's why we are so adamant that in practice, if we find any of these interventions to actually act as a kind of hindrance on growth, we would halt that particular intervention or remove it from the program entirely. You cannot have inclusion or broad-based economic opportunity without following a growth-first agenda.
Now, how big a break on growth do you think is this uncertainty about Section 25?
I mean, hugely, because obviously, these rights are a core part of being able to function in a market-driven economy. And we maintain that that is still our focus, that the government has a strong role to play. But primarily, governments don't create jobs. The private sector does. And the government has to create an environment that will facilitate that kind of job growth.
Gwen, thank you very much.
Thank you.